Hey everybody, it's Jennifer Kahnweiler back with another edition of Introverted Leaders Around the World. I am so thrilled today to introduce you to my guest. I have to say, I met this individual through social media. So everybody gives social media a bad rap, but we are both champions and advocates and allies for introverts in the world. And Iain Wilke and I kind of met through LinkedIn and kind of continued that conversation. And I wanted to share him to share his thoughts and experience with you because I thought it would be so helpful to hear his perspective coming from also Great Britain. So welcome, Iain.
Thank you very much, Jennifer. It's lovely to be here. It really is. And to be talking with you and your audience.
Yeah. Well, thanks. Same here. Let me introduce folks to you. And you call yourself a quiet leadership coach. Iain is an accredited executive coach, and he helps introverted leaders around the world, thrive in an extroverted business world. He combines his coaching skills with his experience as an introvert who rose to the challenge of becoming a senior partner in EY, and I think that's Ernst and Young, am I right?
Yeah, Ernst and Young. Yeah.
For those people who don't know, he was a member of the firm's UK and Ireland leadership team and chair of the Partner Code of Conduct Committee. And Iain often gives talks on quiet leadership, the quiet leadership journey, and he's the founder of Pathmaker Consulting and a member of Sherwood PSF Consulting. He's also the founder of the charity 50 Million Voices, which collaborating with leaders from 15 countries to transform the global workplace for people who stutter. And this includes leading events and workshops for employers and people who stutter. And as an experienced leader of cultural change for disability at work, Iain is also a trustee of the Business Disability Forum and was the first ever winner of their coveted Disability Smart Executive Champion Award. So congratulations, Iain, and thank you for being here.
Thank you very much, Jennifer. Yeah.
So great. Well, we're looks like a sunny day there in England, or perhaps some light there.
It's a lovely autumn day here. Yeah.
Lovely, lovely. It's not always dark and dreary, as they say, right? We're going to go back a little bit. I want you to take us back to your first earliest memory of your first job. And what that was like. I like to ask people that. And what did you learn from that experience?
Well, it's a really great question. Really, my first job was working on fruit farms. We lived in Kent, which is sometimes referred to as the Garden of England, in that it's a very rural county. Mm-hmm. And around where I lived with my father and stepmother, there were a lot of fruit farms where the blackcurrants, raspberries, strawberries, growing hops, you know, for beer. So that was my first job. And I think, gosh, what did I learn? I learned, even before I got that job, just how hard it was to get a job. You know, I remember going into the jobs for me, nothing. I remember walking up and down the high street of the local big town, which was Tunbridge Wells, going into every shop there, nothing. And it was just quite a shock. You know, I'd grown up middle-class family, heard unemployment figures on the news, but suddenly it became very real. So I experienced a real sort of really emotional downside of wanting work and nobody wanting me. So I think that was the first thing I learned, and ever since that, the unemployment stats haven't been stats anymore. They've been about real people and real families. So that was kind of before I started the job. And then it was about planting raspberry bushes or canes, and then coming back and sort of harvesting the raspberries. I remember working on a blackcurrant farm. And this is my second real learning. Was there was a dispute between the workers, of which I was one, and the farm manager about when we were going to get paid, because they'd lined it up that we'd get paid on a Friday, but only for the work till the Thursday, which meant on the final week we had to come back on the Friday to get our money, which meant you lost work somewhere else. And it was essentially a tactic for them not to have to pay you for that final Friday. And one of the workers on the team that I was in basically broke the blackcurrant picking machine. He kind of knew how it works. It was a real case of industrial sabotage. And again, I was doing, my I was very keen on history. So I knew about all this stuff that happened 200 years ago. And there I was in this field in Kent. Wow. And the worker had broken the machine until the farm manager agreed that we were going to get paid fully on the Thursday for our work to the end of Friday. So suddenly I was in the reality of, wow, not having a job, this feels really bad. And then actually seeing that little industrial dispute play out on the fields of Kent. So yeah, those are really interesting learnings, I think, and things you don't really learn in the classroom. You kind of read about it, but
yeah,
to be right in the middle of that.
Yeah, so you did really go full force in and learning early on what it was like in the workplace, right?
At the sort of hard end of the workplace, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, and how,
yeah,
and how that sort of boss worker dynamic can play out in a toxic way.
Did you think you took any lessons from that? You became a leader and tell us, you moved into it, like you have a partner role, I believe, and you had lots of leadership positions. Yeah. What was your approach to leadership that maybe connected somewhat to your early experiences?
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, on the main farm I worked on, I was made a team leader, and that was quite interesting because I had people on a team of eight, ranging from age 16, I was 19, so age 16 through to probably 45, 46. So just leading that sort of team. I think my leadership style has always been to really be interested in people. You know, I think if you look after people, and I was always genuinely interested in people, and you combine around a common goal, you know, whether that's doing a great audit for Ernst and Young, picking blackberries, or changing the world for people who stutter, you know, if you've got that combined goal and you treat people well, and when things go wrong, you hopefully deal with it away from the noise and in a private place, then that's a pretty good starting point, you know. So now people would say, you know, can you be too supportive? I would say, you know, I think I engendered a lot of loyalty in the people who worked for me, but I did get criticized for being too soft. But somehow I think in the medium term, that was fine. You know, I think people do take advantage of you if you're maybe too empathetic. You know, perhaps you don't get allocated the team you wanted to be allocated because they'd rather work for somebody else, or the people sharing out the work would rather face it down with me than with somebody who's perhaps less accommodating. But I think, you know, if you treat people well and you show a genuine interest in them, then they'll pay you back in spades.
So you built that loyalty throughout and trust. Like you said, some people might not have been gone to you because they thought you were too accommodating. Tell me about the choice that you made. It's interesting because you were interested and curious. You said you read a lot about history and business. How did you choose, and what was the direction, the career path you chose early on, and why do you think that was?
I really chose, it was a long time ago, and there was a... you know, deep recession in the UK in the early 1980s when I was looking for a full-time job. And really there wasn't much else. I'd always intended to get a professional qualification in something. I felt that would sort of set me up well. And I chose accountancy. I was good with numbers. Mm-hmm. What I found with accountancy actually, and particularly auditing, was it was actually almost more about people. It was more about leading teams, building global teams, building trusting relationships with your team and trusting relationships with your clients. It was about values, you know, standing up and ensuring your clients were following the appropriate accounting rules. So I found once I'd qualified, actually the work became more interesting as it became as much about people as it was about the numbers and what lay beneath. And I found that actually as a quieter person, I was good at building one-to-one relationships. You know, I would listen to my clients and understand what they wanted. And, or if it was an organization we were trying to build relationships with to get business from, I was good at just listening to them. And when people feel they've been heard, they respond well to that. So even though I was quieter and I think certainly less demonstrative than many of my fellow partners, I won a lot of work, and I think I won that work and won a lot of clients for the firm just because ultimately people choose you for pretty straightforward reasons. You know, they believe you can do the job. Well, you're from Ernst & Young. You know, it's one of the big four accounting firms in the world. You can do the job. And they choose you because they trust you, you know. And how do you build that trust? Well, you build that through investing time in people and getting to know them. And then when things go wrong, and they do go wrong, you know, then you've got that bedrock of that trusting relationship. And I think that was hopefully a sort of another aspect of my leadership style, which was I'd always, when things went wrong, I'd always say, we pull together, we don't pull apart. You know, we pull the team together and we'll work through it. And then when we've done that, we'll look back and work out what went wrong and why, and then we can maybe fix it for next time. So, you know, I just think, you know, people talk about great clients, great service, great quality, great values. Actually, all of those come from having great people and treating those people well. Mm-hmm. If you don't have great people, you don't get great clients, you don't have great service, and you risk your values. So, you know, for me, it became more and more about treating people well, and hopefully that being reciprocated.
And I love what you focused on is some of the strengths of introverts, Iain. The one-on-one building, you know, it's taking the time to have those focused conversations, listening, engaged listening, which are the hallmarks of introverts who make a difference and influence and lead. So it sounds like you did that with your teams as well as with your customers and clients. People oftentimes think that introverts can't, as you say, win business or you say something like, right, to gain business. And you had to do that to be successful in a you know, large accounting firm. That's worldwide.
I mean, that's worldwide. I mean, I can remember one major client that we were hoping to win their audit of. Mm-hmm. And I remember sitting down with the chief financial officer and saying, you know, how are we doing? You know, how am I doing? If Ernst and Young pitches for your audit and I'm the partner, you know, how will that be for you? How's my style? And he said, Iain, you're fine. Don't worry about it. You're fine. And I said, well, you're bound to say that. And he said, no, let me tell you, the guy from, and I won't name the firm, but there's another big four firm. He said, he's already lost it. He is on the phone. He's constantly hassling me. I've told my assistant not to put him through. He's just irritating me. You've got that balance right. You know, you come to me if you've got a good question or you've got something to suggest, but otherwise you leave me alone. Now, I was thinking, you know, got to win this audit. Got to, you know, I'm thinking about, should I take him an idea? Should I not? Am I hassling him? Am I visible enough? So it wasn't like, it wasn't easy. I'm not saying it was a sort of natural thing that I've just got it right. I mean, you have to think these things through. I remember one time actually when this guy first became appointed as chief financial officer, he came in from another organization. We as a firm didn't know him. And I called him. I wanted to come and meet him and he wasn't there. And I left a voicemail. And this is true. I recorded that voicemail 13 times. It took me half an hour just to say, hello, it's Iain Wilke. I'm from Ernst & Young. I'd love to come and see you. Because it just needed to be the right tone, you know, the right length, the right tone. And I remember pressing sort of final on it and thinking, oh my goodness, if the previous 12 have also been recorded, I'm in trouble. He's going to think I'm some weirdo, but it didn't, you know. But I think it's a question of accuracy, isn't it? It's a question of building that relationship and just getting it right. You know, that first contact's so key in a quiet, understated way.
In a quiet, understated way. And what you're, again, I like pulling out what the strengths are here. And of course, the preparation that is, you know, to a fault, right? And I'm sure you do that in other aspects of your life. But preparing so diligently and also practicing so you got it right and people think, and then so it looks natural. And you also it sounds like you also kind of pick out the style, figure out the style and find and ask people how you're doing, right? You can't guess that. You want to get that feedback. Do you do that fairly often with your clients and with to try to get understand how to fit their style?
Definitely, you know, in the sense of, I want to help my clients, you know, so if I'm not helpful, then I'd really love them to tell me. I mean, in a sort of coaching situation, it'll often be a colleague that will make that call, you know, how's it going with Iain? And because one of the challenges I have as a coach, having been in business for 35 years or in a big corporate business like that, mm-hmm. I have a lot of experience to share.
Yes.
And that balance as a coach between how much you help them, you know, come to their goals, identify what the blockages are and work their way through those blockages, and how much you might share. And you know, if you like, purist coaching would say you should share nothing.
Right.
Whereas actually some of the feedback I get is, we love it when Iain shares his story.
I want to hear your experience.
Because I got a whole pack, I got 35 years worth, right? But I also, when I do share a story, I always make a note of it against that coachee's name, so I don't share the same story with them next time, okay? So it's that balance, isn't it? You have so much to share, and when you feel an example may just help them unlock that blockage or that limiting assumption they have, well, why wouldn't I share it? But I have to share it in a way that fits their need, not my ambition, not my enthusiasm to tell my own story.
Excellent point. So let's move the conversation a little bit to introversion. And I want to understand a little more of when you first found out about it and realized and connected with the concept and sort of took it as your own. Just share with me what that experience was like and any comments around identifying as an introvert or an introverted leader.
Yeah. I mean, I was always described as very shy when I was a little boy. And that continued really, although I can be very, very outgoing. You know, I think a lot of it's about, I suppose, confidence, but who you're with, the sort of environment you're in. I was then in boarding school. My mother was very ill, and I used to stay behind after school and for every night during the week, and then I'd go home at weekends. And then she died when I was 9. And then after that, I was in another boarding school. So vacations, you know, the long summer holiday, Easter holiday, and the long summer holiday, I was on my own. My dad would go off to work. My brother's older, and he sort of had his friends, and then he actually went into the Navy. So I had several years there where I spent a lot of time on my own, and it was lonely, you know, at times, but also I learned to be really independent. I learned how to get around, you know, I kind of grew up very quickly. And by contrast, when I went back to school, I was, you know, I was good at sports. I was often team captain or you know, playing a prominent role in those areas, which had very high sort of value attached to them in a largely boys' school. So, but I was very aware through those teenage years that actually my interpersonal skills were pretty poor, you know, and meeting new people in groups was challenging. So that's when I think I was really aware that I was quieter. Some of that I think was natural and some of it was circumstantial. And I really became aware of it when I started properly in business, where I was very reluctant to speak up. You know, I'd perhaps know the answer to a question, but I wouldn't put my hand up either because I was just embarrassed, or if I was worried that I would stutter, and then that all the sort of embarrassment and the laughter that can come with that. So, but also just a sense often of not sharing ideas because I didn't feel they were worthy. And then I would get very annoyed with myself going home and think, but you had a good idea there, Iain, and why didn't you share it? Because somebody else shared it later in the meeting and they all thought it was a great idea. So I think, yeah, I was very aware of my reluctance, the sort of feeling not good enough. I mean, ironically, I was more than good enough. You know, I made it to the top of the firm. And I suppose that journey, I think I was very helped by two partners who really believed in me a lot more than I believed in myself. They gave me opportunities. And I think that was very important to have that support. And also I just got to a point where I was just fed up. I was just fed up of always holding back. I think I was very aware of it. And then I decided to do something about it. I became braver about taking risks. Some of them succeeded. So one of the roles I was offered was to be head of audit training for the whole audit business. It had always been a partner who'd done that role. I wasn't a partner then. And I said, no, I'm not doing it. You know, I don't like speaking in public. And the partner who offered me the job said, I know, that's why I'm offering you to do it. And I said, well, you know, he was the only partner that ever talked to me about my stutter. And I said, well, you know, I stutter. He said, I know, Iain, and it's holding you back and you're making it hold you back. And I want you to do this role. And I said, I'm not doing it. He was a really senior partner. He was on the board. And I was like, oh, I'm not doing it. And he said, you go away and come back in 48 hours. And I came and said, okay, I'll give it a go. So, and I did give it a go and I loved it. You know, I loved it. So I really grew through that. So that was a risk I took that succeeded. And then a risk I took that where I felt I'd really failed was actually, I was at the memorial service for one of our senior partners. And there was, and his wife asked if I'd read at his, it's called Richard, his memorial service in Southwark Cathedral, big cathedral in South London, near the office. And I agonized over, I really wanted to do it. I'm a very competitive person. It was a really real thing to be asked to read at Richard Finlater's funeral. He was global vice president in the firm. And I was the only serving partner to be asked. In the end, I said yes, but I was very worried that I would stutter. And I tried to persuade them to change the reading to word, you know, to actually something from Tuesdays for Morrie, that lovely book, but they wanted something from the Old Testament. So there I was in front of 650 people. Oh, and wow. I stuttered for Britain, you know, and my stutter was coming back off the far wall of the cathedral. And I thought, oh my goodness, I've let Richard down, I've let his family down, I've let the firm down, I've let myself down. And because I defined doing a good reading as not stuttering, you know, and I came off that and I was very upset with myself. And I felt I'd humiliated myself really, but actually it encouraged me to think, Iain, you're doing really well in your career, but your relationship with your speech is still like this demon inside you. So I started to look, I got in touch with the British Stammering Association, and then I set up a network at EY for people who stutter, which that was more than, that was 10 years ago now. Then I set up one nationally with the British Stammering Association called the Employer Stammering Network. And now I've set up 50 million voices, which is global. None of that would have happened if I hadn't had that humiliation at Southwark Cathedral. If I hadn't taken that chance, failed publicly by my own value set at the time. But actually, what a success that was, you know. And I think it's a beautiful example, it's a very painful example of how by taking a risk, taking a risk, sometimes you do fail, but you can turn that failure into a positive, you know, into a strength. And and last year I was launching 50 million voices at the Global Stuttering Conference in Iceland. And I thought, well, this date feels familiar. It was the opening talk, one of the three opening talks. And it was the 24th of June. And I thought, this date's familiar. And I went back through my diary. It was 10 years to the day since Richard's memorial service, since I'd stuttered, with all that personal individual humiliation. And there I was saying, hey world, we're gonna do, you know, come and join this movement. It's 50 million, there's 50 million people who stutter globally of employable age. That's why I called it 50 million voices, 50 million voices struggling to be heard at work. And I thought, wow, there's something really big going on here, so.
Wow, Iain, totally blown away and so inspirational. And the way you can look at your experience as one, and I think a transition to what you could share with people for advice who either are introverted and afraid to speak up, and stutter, you know, stutterers. And they're not the same, of course.
But they are both, you know, people or types of people who are struggling to have their voice heard.
Yes.
When they, you know, and that's why. And I think it's introverts, but it's also people perhaps from different cultures or people speaking a second or third language, or
perhaps
you're on medication, or women. You know, I've had a lot of women say to me, it's so frustrating when I make a point and nobody listens, and then a man makes that point and they all go, hey, awesome. So I think this quiet leadership thing, it's really valuable to different people in different ways.
Yeah, I love that because we talk a lot about intersectionality, different, you know, aspects of diversity. And, you know, think about we have extroverts who are stutterers, but introverts and stutterers. So how do we look at these not so much as labels, but like what are the behaviors we can put in place, right, to overcome that? So as we go towards the end of the interview, I just want to ask you, so what would be some pointers you might have for people who are afraid or, you know, have to speak up and, like you said, do this whole imposter syndrome in their head, or just, you know, you didn't use those terms, but kind of put themselves down so that they don't express themselves. Because the point is, we're not only are they not experiencing the success, but we, you know, you think about it from the workplace, we're losing out on, you know, so many voices, like you say, voices.
Yeah. I mean, I think my encouragement would be to be a proud introvert. You know, I think it is, I think when you look at the qualities of truly successful leaders, a lot of them are introvert qualities, if you like. Mm-hmm. You know, listening is, I was at an event last year with, on International Disabilities Day, and the chief exec of this global bank was there. And he was asked, what are the most important sort of strengths you need to be a successful chief executive? And he said, without a doubt, listening. He said, I've learned that I contribute more by listening to everybody that comes to see me. I can share my advice, I can share my viewpoint, but they're the expert, not me. Or I can maybe refer them to somebody else in the bank or outside the bank that I know that can help them. And by helping them, I'm helping the bank. So I think introverts have that strength around listening. I would encourage to build one-to-one relationships, build your allies, and actually build allies who are extroverts, you know, because ask them to help you to get into the conversation, not as an afterthought at the end of the meeting. Oh, Bill, have you got anything to say? But ask them to bring you in early. You know, I know Bill's got something interesting to say, because you can then help the extrovert perhaps with, maybe they do a bit of over talking and you can develop a sort of signal to say, you know, whatever it is. So I would encourage you, you know, to build allies and really know what your personal strengths are and to work on them, to make them even better. So if you're a great writer or if you enjoy writing, become a better writer, find different ways to write. You know, going virtual and meetings being online, many of the virtual platforms have a text function. So if you can't get in by speaking, write your point in the text. And one of my coaching clients has started to do that a lot, and he's thrilled with the impact it's having. He's a bright guy. Mm-hmm. And if you can't get in, then maybe send a private message to the chair of the meeting, if you can do that, and say, I've got a great point to make, can you please bring me in? So I think, you know, play to that writing strength, if that's what you have. Your weaknesses, like, you know, I had a weakness around public speaking, for sure. I was scared of it, and I would do all sorts of things to avoid it. But actually, I don't think my weakness was around public speaking. My weakness was around feeling that I didn't have anything interesting to say, or feeling that I might stutter, or that I wasn't as good as the smooth talking guy. But actually, I do have interesting stuff. Introvert people have lots of interesting things to say. Secondly, actually nobody really cared that I stuttered too much, you know? And thirdly, not everybody likes a slick, smooth speaker. Where you really connect with people is when you speak authentically from the heart, you know, not from the mouth, from the heart. Mm-hmm. And that's what comes back at you. So my encouragement would be to find little ways to do little talks, just a little bit, a couple of minutes with some friends, practice it. If it goes well, great. If it doesn't go well, that's no bad thing. Just keep on going and eventually you'll get it.
Iain, such incredible tips. I'm sure people are going to replay that part, because there was so much richness in there about practical things that we can do to not only build up that confidence, but really actually tactically to get our voices in the room and to connect with others. Yeah. We've been kind of serious now. Before I ask you, you know, to give some leads of where people can find you and find information, I want to, you know, what about Iain, the fun person, the person, I know you were talking about music, and I want you to know, as we've been talking, the sun has been, I think it's been going down because we're in England, okay. We're in England, and it's creating a wonderful backdrop there. Just an aside.
We do have sunshine in England, you see.
You do. You're making that point very subtly, but directly. What do you like to do for fun when you're not serious about work?
Well, I love to be outdoors. You know, I love nature and walking, cycling, exercise. I really get a real buzz from that. I make sure I get out every day. And in lockdown, you know, I've been like making, whenever I go out for a walk, I'll find three things to remind me how beautiful our world is. It might be a leaf, or it might be the wind, it might be just stop and listen to the sounds. Yes. It might be the children going into school. It doesn't have to be, but I'm looking for real sort of positives of life, really. So I love being outdoors and That really nourishes me. I do love music. I have a guitar, a couple of guitars. I play my guitar every day. I use it as my work break, really. It stimulates different part of my brain. It picks me up. I'm in a local choir. It's not a very good one. It's an enthusiastic choir. Let's put it that way. And I love to listen to music. First thing I do every morning is come into the kitchen and put a couple of songs on just to get me into the day.
Well, I love that. And I love the idea of the gratitude for the noticing and being present when we're on our walks and not just always having our phone on, you know, and being there. And you said tap into other parts of your brain that will help your other work.
Definitely. You know, and I think if we just stop and look closely, there's so much beauty in our world. And I think, you know, it is, you know, switch off the TV and the radio and the screen.
Very helpful.
So I think those two things are very much me, you know, the outdoors and the music and animals as well, you know, so.
So let's just talk about how folks can connect with you. And I'm also going to put this in our description, but perhaps you could just say, I know we kind of said it in passing, but Iain is a very active executive coach. And so tell us how people can reach you that, and also for the stuttering information.
Yeah, sure. So feel free to reach me on LinkedIn, connect with me on LinkedIn or on Twitter, which is Wilke_Iain, or just direct email me, which is Iain@IanWilke.com.
No, we'll put it in there, no problem.
So Iain being I-A-I-N at IanWilke.com. And then that's for anything really, including quiet leadership coaching, or just a conversation. If it's stuttering, you can get me on those, or you can email me at chair@50millionvoices.org.
Okay, great. So thank you so much. There. Oh my gosh, this was so rich. And I'm going to be listening, as I say, as our listeners are. When I posted this on LinkedIn that Iain was going to come on, folks, I got all these incredible comments that showed me how well respected and adored you are by your community. So I'm not surprised. And now I totally see why. So thank you so much for making the time today to join us. And we look forward to hearing from our listeners. And thank you so much. And you have a wonderful day.
I'd just like to thank you for all you do for introverts, because I think I've read you describe yourself as an extrovert. And I do know that whether it's for introverts or whether it's for people who stutter or people who are gay or whatever, where it's actually the allies that will pull us over the line. You know, I think it's and so the work you're doing and have done over many years, Jennifer, it's invaluable. And I just want to thank you for that. I suppose in a way for introverts, but also personally. And certainly on behalf of some of my coaching clients, many of whom are use the 4P model, so the 4P framework.
Very enthusiastic. That makes my heart feel really full today. So thank you so much. We'll see you guys soon. Take care. Bye.